So DZRH, the Elizalde.
Look at the bus, it's time to mend.
A corporate thing.
So ang sinasabi ko na lang.
Isang mapayapang hapon, Pilipinas. Narito ang inyong balerina ng bayan, si Lisa Macuja, na bumabati sa lahat ng nakikinig sa atin sa DZRH at sa lahat ng nanonood ng RHTV, lalong-lalo na sa ating mga kasamahang alagad ng sining at kultura sa buong bansa. Tuwing ikawalo ng Marso, ipinagdiriwang sa buong mundo ang International Women's Day upang kilalanin ang malaking kontribusyon ng mga kababaihan sa pagsulong ng lipunan at para mabigyang pansin ang mga issue na kinakaharap nila, lalo na ang pagiging biktima ng pang-aabuso at karahasan. Pero alam nyo ba na dito sa Pilipinas, hindi lamang isang araw ang ating itinalaga para sa pagkilala sa mga kababaihan? Noong 1988, idineklara ang Proclamation No. 224, kung saan ang unang linggo ng Marso ay ipinagdiriwang bilang Women's Week. Samantalang sa Proclamation No. 227 naman, itinalaga ang buong buwan ng Marso bilang Women's Role in History Month. Bilang pakikiisa sa mga pagdiriwang na ito, ang ating pag-uusapan sa hapong ito ay tungkol sa isang global movement para sa pagsusulong ng women's agenda, lalo na sa mga usaping social injustice at violence against women. At makakasama natin ngayon ang dalawa sa pinakamasigasig na leader ng grupong ito na parehong premyadong alagad ng sining and at the same time, mga respetadong women's advocates na kilala sa buong mundo. Kaya't huwag kayong aalis, samahan ninyo kami sa kalahating oras ng masaya at makabuluhang usapan tungkol sa 1 Billion Rising Movement kasama sina Eve Ensler at Monique Wilson.
Ang 1 Billion Rising ay isang global movement na itinatag ng American playwright, performer, and activist na si Eve Ensler na nakilala para sa kanyang dulang The Vagina Monologues. Sinimulan niya ang 1 Billion Rising noong 2012 bilang bahagi ng taunang V-Day movement na may layuning makalikom ng pondo para tulungan ang mga kababaihang biktima ng karahasan at sexual abuse. Taon-taon, mula Pebrero hanggang ikawalo ng Marso, libu-libong rising events ang ginagawa sa mahigit na 200 mga bansa upang makiisa sa pag-aalsa laban sa karahasan at pang-aabuso. Mahalagang bahagi ng mga events na ito ang sama-samang pagsayaw ng mga kababaihang advocates at ng mga dating biktima ng karahasan upang ipamalas sa nakararami ang kanilang pagkakaisa at aktibong pag-aaklas laban sa anumang uri ng pang-aabuso. Sa ngayon, ang 1 Billion Rising Campaign ay sinasabing biggest mass global action to end violence against women. Sa hapong ito, ikinararangal naming makasama sa Art2art ang dalawa sa mga haligi ng 1 Billion Rising, ang founder na si Ms. Eve Ensler at ang kasalukuyang global director nito, ang tanyag na Filipino theater artist na si Ms. Monique Wilson.
Good afternoon, Eve. Good afternoon, Monique.
Good
and
afternoon.
Welcome to Art2art.
Good afternoon.
You.
Thank you for having us.
Finally, I get you here at Art2art.
Thank you for inviting me.
It's such a fantastic opportunity. Well, it's truly an honor to have you both on our show.
Thank you.
Monique, you were here before.
Yes, some time ago. And congratulations on your ninth year anniversary.
Yeah, I know. I think it was in the first year of Art2art when we were still just radio.
Mm-hmm.
And welcome back.
Thank you.
To Art2art.
Thank you.
Okay, let's start from the first time, because we're having Eve on the show for the first time. Let's start by introducing her to our audience. Let's talk a little about your beginnings as a playwright, Eve, before going into 1 Billion Rising. So you are, of course, known for over a dozen plays, books, and screenplays, but your most popular work remains to be The Vagina Monologues, which has been translated into 48 languages and performed in over 140 countries since its first staging in 1996. Wow. Okay, so can you tell us what
the little vagina that could?
Yeah, I know. Okay, let's talk about what first inspired you to write the vagina monologues.
You know, I wish I could tell you it was something really lofty, and it was really just curiosity. Uh-huh. Do you know, I was talking to an older woman who was a feminist who was going through menopause, and mm-hmm. she was talking about her vagina, which you'll do if you're going through menopause. Mm-hmm. And she just said things about her vagina that I found really surprising, that it was dried up and dead and finished, and I was like, wow. Uh-huh, and uh-huh. I was kind of shocked. So I thought to myself after that meeting, I don't really know what women think about their vagina. So mm-hmm. I would just say to a friend, well, what do you think about your... And every woman that I said it to would be like... Uh-huh. Would just say the wildest. The first woman said, my mother used to tell me, don't wear underpants underneath your pajamas. You need to air out your pussycat. That was the first woman. And I was like, okay, there's something here. Uh-huh. And then one woman would say, well, you should talk to my friend. She has an amazing story about her vagina. And another woman would say, so before I know it, I was kind of sucked down this vagina trail. Mm-hmm. And it's now many years later. I still haven't gotten off, you know.
Uh-huh. Okay, and of course, working on the vagina monologues together is what brought the two of you together,
yes,
right?
Yes, because not long after she wrote it, it evolved into a movement called the V-Day movement, which is a movement to end violence against women and girls. So many of us across the world, me being a theater actress and producer, found the vagina monologues. Mm-hmm. We didn't know each other yet. Mm-hmm. We wrote to acquire the rights, and we did it through our theater company here, the New Voice Company, as an advocacy tool as well, to mm-hmm. empower women, to incite women, to, you know, help transform society. Mm-hmm. So that really kind of began our long relationship now, which is, mm-hmm. I think, 16, 17 years old now, because mm-hmm. that's how long ago we've done vagina monologues here with uh-huh. Gabriella. Uh-huh. And it's really grown from there. And I think it's really amazing when you can find kind of fellow artists who can marry both art and activism and continue to do so. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I have to say, when I first, we used to write each other, it wasn't even email, it was faxes uh-huh. in
yeah.
those days.
And snail mail.
Yeah,
yes.
You know, and I thought Monique was an old woman, because uh-huh. or a real older woman, because she was so efficient, so professional, uh-huh, so uh-huh. talented. So, and so when I met her in New York, I remember mm-hmm. going, you're a child. How old are you? She was like...
Well, she thought I was 12, but yeah, I was like,
you know,
I was
Asians look younger, yeah. I got carded a lot. Yeah. Even when I had two, you know, I had two kids already, I still got carded.
I know, yeah. I know. So she was like, you look 12.
Yeah. Who are you? Which, by the way, I say every day now still, because she's such a powerhouse, but... I mean, that was the beginning of mm-hmm. us meeting each other, but she had been doing the vagina monologues before then mm-hmm. for a while.
Yeah, we've been doing vagina monologues a long time, and we've been doing it as part of the V-Day movement, as part of our advocacy, mm-hmm. and then, of course, it grew from there, because in the beginning, when we produced it here in 2000, it was difficult. You know, mm-hmm. we were one of the first ones to produce it, I think, mm-hmm. outside the U.S., like mm-hmm. in Asia. Mm-hmm. We took it to Hong Kong, Singapore, Japan, and here in the Philippines, there was some resistance to it.
There
and
was I the just, shock factor,
yes,
of course,
and I,
yeah.
now it's so easy now, yeah. we can say vagina. But, you know, in those days, even before I actually physically met you, like, I would call or email and say, can you help us explain this to people? Like, it was, there was a journey mm-hmm. we all had to go through, all of us who produced it in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And really, it was there to tell us, look, you know, these are real stories. These are like, you know, you just have to stand by them and have conviction. And, yeah. you know, and art is autonomous. You know, mm-hmm. we can't change it kind of for people. This is really for people to see and hear and respond to. And I think that's really what made it very successful here and mm-hmm. in all the places that where we produced it.
Mm-hmm. I think, mm-hmm. too, with the vagina monologues, it doesn't really matter what country it was. Mm-hmm. I remember, like, even Paris was one of the latest to do it, and they wanted to change the title. I was like, you're Paris. They've already done it in the Philippines. Like, come on,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But I think part of it is doing the play was such about breaking the silence, breaking taboos, bringing another energy forward, bringing women forward in a way that was... where we had agency over our stories, over our bodies. Mm-hmm. And I think every country, every culture had the same issues, because the world is totally patriarchal.
Yeah.
I've yet to be anywhere where the world is not dominated by patriarchy. Mm-hmm. So I think every time it broke through, mm-hmm. whether it was religious culture or just a very conservative culture, it was like, in the performance, in the producing, in everything, you mm-hmm. were part of that breakthrough, mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, over the years, it's been, what, 20 years?
Yeah, Vagina it's Monologues 20 years. Yeah. Yeah. Have been around,
so
yes.
Can you tell us how that, you know, how Vagina Monologues has evolved over the years and the many stagings in the different countries? Has it evolved? And oh, I'm yeah. sure it has.
You're so good yes. at it.
Well, because I kind of have the Asian perspective because we're Asian producers. Mm-hmm. It definitely has evolved because in the beginning, first of all, you know, artists were very scared to do it. They wanted to do it, but, you know, it required self-empowerment from even the people who were acting it out. Mm-hmm. And then basically when we got all the actresses on board, mm-hmm. you know, we then brought it to various grassroots communities. Mm-hmm. Because I also realized that it doesn't have to be an actor to do it. Like, these were such powerful monologues that anyone could do it. Anyone could embrace that truth, that power, and get empowered while you're doing it. Then we saw so many colleges do it because the youth also mm-hmm. were insisting and demanding to do it because, you know, they were facing various forms of abuse. Mm-hmm. And I think where that has evolved, it politicized the spaces that we all brought it in. Mm-hmm. I think I can safely speak for many of us who produce it all around the world. Mm-hmm. It first began, just like for me, mm-hmm. as an artistic piece. Mm-hmm. But inside the artistic piece, it really politically educated us. It opened our eyes to our social issues in our own communities, in our mm-hmm. own countries. Mm-hmm. So that process began our own political education for the mm-hmm. many of us artists who've done it. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, it also brought us in touch and in connection with all the grassroots communities. Mm-hmm. And then we as artists realized that, you know, art cannot just stand alone on its own unless it was contextualized, unless it was also held in communities and also was in connection with actual realities that mm-hmm. were happening. Mm-hmm. Then the art becomes transformative.
Yeah.
The art becomes alive and mm-hmm. current, mm-hmm. and that's why we can still do Vagina Monologues to this day. Yeah. Because sadly, uh-huh. I mean, all the violence against women issues are everywhere. Yeah. We're mm-hmm. hearing everywhere that, mm-hmm. like, you know, like even students now are like, we have to do it. We have many. We also know that in schools they made it now part of the curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
Like in St. Scholastica's College, they were just telling us, look, mm-hmm. it's part of our high school curriculum now.
Fantastic.
Because then you want the empowerment to happen like much younger, mm-hmm. as opposed to. With us, you know, my empowerment happened with Vagina Monologues at age 28. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's pretty late. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, you want it to happen when they're children so they don't go through the same stages yeah. we did.
Yeah, that's
right. No, and I also think the play and everything that's happened has informed me as a writer what needs to happen next. Mm. For example, just meeting the comfort women and having the experience of knowing the comfort women and the fact that they hadn't gotten justice inspired me to write a monologue and to do a spotlight that year on the comfort women. 10 years ago, trans women came to me and they said, we really want to be part of this and mm-hmm. would you write a monologue that was, you know, we're based on interviews with us. So I went away for a week with trans women and we sat and I listened and I wrote a monologue mm-hmm. and we did the first trans women's production. Mm-hmm. And I think it's been like that in every community. Like, how can the play kind of shape and find itself to serve mm-hmm. and be in solidarity with different communities? And mm-hmm. I think that's been like mm-hmm. such an exciting part of the journey.
Yeah.
You know, learning like how the play, and I think also people take the play and they bring it. You know, I've never actually promoted the play.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I've never tried to get people to do the play because mm-hmm. I always knew there had to be radical, brave producers like, you know, Monique and Rosanna, who bought it to the Philippines, who were courageous, who wouldn't get scared if people, you know, you can't tell people, oh, you can just go do this play. It's mm-hmm. it's a political journey. It's an artistic journey, but you have to be brave and you mm-hmm. have to like stand up to something. So the people have found the play
uh-huh.
and they've bought it. And even this year, I was just looking at the numbers, like this is the 20th year, 800 places will do the play over the next month.
Yeah.
And that's like amazing. And you uh-huh. look at these little towns and you look at colleges, little high schools, uh-huh. but where women are just boldly going, we're going to talk about vaginas yeah. and we're going to talk about rape and we're going to talk about incest and we're going to mm-hmm. talk about whatever the issues are, economic exploitation,
mm-hmm.
migrant workers, you know, selling of women, trafficking mm-hmm. of women, you know?
And mm-hmm. I think it's, as we all know, because we're all like live performance artists,
mm-hmm.
there's something about coming together in a space and that kind of energy.
Mm-hmm.
And I always knew like long ago when I began as an artist that there's something very powerful about live art, like what art can do when mm-hmm. people are gathered together in a theater.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the Vagina Monologues, for me personally, proved it.
Mm-hmm.
It really proved yeah. it. Because you saw the changes happening as you were performing yeah. it, uh-huh. as you were in in the same kind of space and energy with the people watching.
Yeah.
You know, when we would do it with migrant workers and with domestic workers, it really brings to the surface their issues. And it's so potent and so powerful. I can't explain it enough, like how sacred that space is, because mm-hmm. in that moment you really are together mm-hmm. in that awakening.
That's right. But because the success of the Vagina Monologues is, and V-Day, of course, it's so huge. Yeah. Is there any way that you are still like monitoring, or how do you choose, for example, the producers that you give?
Well, you have to sign up to do the play during the month of February with the V-Day. You know, with V-Day. And you have to register it. And because it's given away free, you have to show that the money you raise will go to local groups that work to stop violence against women. Mm-hmm. So, you know, over these years, we've raised about $100 million just from people doing productions. All of that has gone to grassroots groups.
Mm-hmm.
Then the rest of the year, you know, DPS manages it and people do productions. But I have to tell you, it's very hard to manage it. I mean, sometimes I look and go, oh my God. It's just like...
The world feels like they own it in a way it's good.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Uh-huh. I mean, I'm fine with it as long as people don't mix and match and say, oh, we'll have a monologue and then we'll throw in somebody else's monologue. It's a play.
Yeah.
And it has to be done as a play. And I'm saying that to everyone so you can hear me.
Yeah.
You know, please don't change it or transform it or make it into something else. Yeah. But, like, I love the fact, you know, that I can, that, you know, telephone workers in Texas are doing it, and, you know, the variety of people and performers is so immense and so mm-hmm. gorgeous.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, you know, I remember one of the first productions we did in London where there were workers, there were movie stars, there were bankers, mm-hmm. there were, you know, politicians, there were, and everyone was just moaning and mm-hmm. and Rosanna, Monique's partner, has done it in banks
uh-huh.
and like have people in banks perform it.
Yeah.
And to me, I mean, that's just wild. I mean, I did the vaginas are like getting into the banks, you know?
It's amazing.
Subverse them.
Insisting to be heard.
Exactly. In a different way than we think,
that's
you know?
True. Yeah, that's true. Okay. We have to take a break. Marami pa po tayong pag-uusapan tungkol sa women empowerment at ang 1 billion rising kasama ang mga multi-awarded theater artists and women's rights activists na sina Eve Ensler at Monique Wilson. Dito pa rin sa Art2Art, magbabalik po kami pagkatapos na ilang paalala.
Programang hatid ay sining at kulturang para sa lahat. Magbabalik ang Art2Art. Schedule ng mga inaabangang konsyerto, update sa mga magagandang panoorin sa mga tanghalan at teatro. Narito na ang Art2Art Calendar.
Narito ang ating Arts Calendar. Sa musika, inihahandog ng CCP Met Opera ang Carmen ni George Bizet na ipalalabas sa March 8, alas 6 ng gabi sa Greenbelt Cinema 5 Ayala Center, Makati City. Tampok ang Georgian mezzo-soprano na si Anita Rechvelishvili sa pangunahing papel bilang Carmen, ang mapanuksong gypsy kasama si Alexander Antonenko bilang Don Jose, soprano Anita Hartig bilang Micaela at Ildar Abrasakov bilang Escamillo. Ang seryeng CCP Met Opera ay bunga ng pag-uugnayan ng Cultural Center of the Philippines at Metropolitan Opera of New York, kung saan ang mga opera ng huli ay pinalalabas sa sinihan dito sa Pilipinas. Para sa karagdagang detalye, tumawag sa 757-7883 o sa 832-3706 o mag-email sa ccpsalesandpromo@gmail.com. Sa teatro, inihahandog ng Sining Lahi Poly Repertory ang dulang Unang Aswang ni Roddy Vera na mapapanood sa pangalawang linggo nito mula March 8 hanggang March 12, alas 2 ng hapon at alas 6 ng gabi sa Hyundai Function Hall, Charlie Del Rosario Building, PUP Mabini Campus, Santa Mesa, Manila. Ang Sining Lahi Poly Repertory ay isang resident student theater group ng Polytechnic University of the Philippines sa loob ng mahigit na 3 dekada. Para sa tiket at iba pang detalye, tumawag sa 0936-123-4443 o sumulat sa Facebook page ng grupo. Samantala, inihahandog Nagbulag naman ang dula ang laboratorio ng Coro de los Diablos sa University of the Philippines Los Baños, Laguna sa March 8, 9 at March 10, alas 4:30 ng hapon at alas 7:30 ng gabi sa Charles Fuller Baker Memorial Hall. Ang Coro de los Diablos ay adaptation ng mandudulang si Layeta Bukoy ng classic novel ni William Golding na Lord of the Flies. Para sa ticket at iba pang detalye, tumawag sa 0915-450-9432 o bumisita sa Facebook page ng grupo.
Usapang sining at kultura para sa lahat, kasama ang balerina ng bayan, si Lisa Macuha. Art to Art.
Kasama pa rin natin ang mga haligi ng 1 Billion Rising Movement na sina Eve Ensler at Monique Wilson. Okay, from the success of the Vagina Monologues and V-Day, where does 1 Billion Rising come into the picture and what is its particular purpose?
Well, I think obviously when I started to perform the Vagina Monologues, I went to many places, and everywhere I went, women would literally line up after the show to talk to me. Mm-hmm. And at first I thought, this is going to be great. I'm going to hear wonderful stories of sex lives and great stories about orgasms. And no, that is not what I heard about. Uh-huh. What most women were lining up to tell me is how they'd been beaten or raped or incested. And I think it was clear that the play was bringing these stories up, and, mm-hmm. and people felt finally they could share it because mm-hmm. I had been sharing all these stories. Mm-hmm. So it was very clear to me, either we were going to do something about the amount of stories I was hearing, mm-hmm. or I was going to stop doing the play because I felt so irresponsible. So in 98, we formed V-Day, which was like, how could we use the play to serve and to change and to really stop violence? To say, we're going to stop it. We're not going to say it's part of the human experience or the human commission, men are just like that. No, men are actually not just like that. They're like that if they choose to be like that. And women can actually determine a different reality, as can men. Mm-hmm. And I think as we've been doing V-Day, we've had many victories over the last 20 years. I mean, look, we're talking here about vaginas. We couldn't do that when we started. Mm-hmm. We've had, there are many, many groups and many activists who were working for the last 30 years to really transform consciousness, to create hotlines, to have rape shelters, to have battered shelters, to have places where, but we haven't ended violence. Mm-hmm. We're still, it's still 1 out of 3 women on the planet, which is 1 billion women. And mm-hmm. that figure just haunts me and was haunting me. And I happened to be in Congo around our 15th year, and I was thinking, what are we going to do? How do we bring this to the next level so we really go the distance and end this violence? And I was dancing with women in Congo, and women in Congo are very powerful dancers. Mm-hmm. That when they dance, the whole earth shakes. Mm-hmm. And I thought, wow, what if we got 1 billion women to, and all the men who love them, mm-hmm. to rise and dance on the same day to say no more to mm-hmm. violence. Mm-hmm. And that was really the idea. We put out a kind of invitation to the world to rise and dance. And it was shocking what happened. Mm-hmm. Literally within hours, it was like, we're rising, we're rising, we're dancing, we're dancing. And it was just, it was, you know what it was? It was clear that both the concept of dancing, mm-hmm. for women who have been exiled from their body, mm-hmm. who have become refugees to their own body, either they've been raped or exploited or abused or trafficked or beaten, the idea of dance was so exciting because it's a way back into your body. Mm-hmm. And to do it collectively, mm-hmm. and to do it in global solidarity, and to do it resisting or rising for what mattered to you and you could determine locally, I think it's just really, people got it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then the first year we had 207 countries who rose and millions of people.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I think it was an audacious call, you know, because in a way, I think its objective also was to tell all our governments and all our institutions and people holding power and the media that you could no longer keep it as a side issue.
Yeah.
You know, we always knew violence was there and we have legislation, we have laws, you know, we talk about it, but it's, there was no more urgency. Mm-hmm. Like, but, you know, when Eve had envisioned it, it was a time when, you know, the statistic at that time of the UN was like 1 in every 3 women will be raped or beaten in her lifetime. Mm-hmm. So if you have 7 billion people on this planet, then that's 1 billion women who are being raped and beaten. Mm-hmm. So how could that not be so astounding to us that yeah. we would be raging and doing in the streets and doing everything we yeah. can to stop it? Yeah. So in a way, that's really also what pulled people in. And also the fact that 207 countries and thousands of millions of people joined in thousands of groups showed us mm-hmm. that people really wanted this too, mm-hmm. you know, because it was a simple call that we put out. Mm-hmm. And in many ways, the response was so overwhelming. Mm-hmm. It also showed that the regular person on the street now mm-hmm. is also tired of this and they want to end it too yeah. mm-hmm. in their own way.
Mm-hmm. So the 1 billion pertains to the number of women that are going to be
reported.
Raped or
beaten. That's just reported. I mean, we're sure that's yeah. more than that. Uh-huh.
Yeah,
you know?
We're sure it's more than yeah. that.
Uh-huh. Okay. But and the 1 billion
which would
rising,
be plenty.
Yeah. It means, you know, we rise.
We dance, we rise, we resist, and in global mm-hmm. solidarity. And, okay. you know, having spent last, you know, few weeks in the Philippines, mm-hmm. Which I love so dearly, and I feel like this is one of my second homes, mm-hmm. you know, for
oh,
so
that's
many,
fantastic.
I know, for so many years I've been coming here. And just loving particularly the Gabriello women and the Gabriello movement and everything they do in this country. Mm-hmm. I really do feel like just give Gabriello movement the government and let them run with it. Mm-hmm. And we'd end exploitation, we'd end poverty, we'd end everything we need to end, and they would actually figure it out how Filipinos could all live well. But mm-hmm. I'm so impressed with them. I can't tell you how impressed mm-hmm. I am. Mm-hmm. You know, I see a lot of women's groups across the planet. I really feel they're a national treasure. And the way they have been able to mobilize and organize over 30 years, mm-hmm. I want to bring them to the States and I want to teach them. Mm-hmm. I want them to teach us, like, how to build a beautiful coalition, multi-sectored, multi-layered mm-hmm. movement, because it's so beautiful. But having traveled with them and Monique mm-hmm. over the last weeks, I see all the ways that Filipino women are suffering. Mm. You know, whether it's Tondo, where women are living in such terrible conditions yeah. and people mm-hmm. are dumping coal, mm-hmm. or whether it's Tacloban, where the survivors of Yolanda are still waiting yeah. for justice, or whether it's the gorgeous Lumad indigenous people who are being, you know, displaced, harassed, murdered by the military, which is trying to absolutely mine and destroy their lands, mm-hmm. or migrant workers, or trafficked workers. I mm-hmm. mean, the women in this country are so powerful, mm-hmm. but the violence being done to them is outrageous.
Mm-hmm. And I think that we can say that about the world.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why I think 1 billion Rising as a movement on its fourth year now is really taken and owned and self-determined by all the communities who are joining it all around the world. Mm-hmm. Because they are tired of something else determining what that future is. Yeah. But they don't want a future of exploitation and increasing violence. They don't want to live defensively. They don't want to live in poverty. Mm-hmm. They don't want to have to tell their girls or their daughters, you know, be careful of everything because that world is bad. No, we want to change and transform that world. Yeah. And I think, you know, in the beginning, we all thought maybe activists would just respond to this, just activists. Some artists, mm-hmm. youth. But the youth risings we saw, yeah. just young people all across the world, artists, I mean, teachers, writers, I mean, everyone across the board. Mm-hmm. Because everyone, I think, began to realize they can contribute mm-hmm. to ending that violence. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what's made 1 billion Rising accessible. Mm-hmm. It's also made it particular and unique because there's mm-hmm. no prescribed way of doing it. Each mm-hmm. community determines how they're going to do it. Mm-hmm. And I think people love to dance. Mm-hmm. I think that's really what we yeah. also realized.
Yeah.
They uh-huh. loved, Filipinos love to dance, but
yes.
all
and
across
sing.
The world.
And
yeah,
sing.
And sing. All across the world, they love it because I think it, as they're dancing with 1 billion Rising, they're gaining empowerment. They're also realizing the power of their bodies and mm-hmm. that the revolution does live in their body because that's the physical thing that's being encased, mm-hmm. that's their cage, that's what's being tortured and abused and exploited and being deprived of things. Mm-hmm. But once that's liberated, the power in yeah. that is so huge.
But mm-hmm. I also, when we were in Davos City, I have to say it was one of my favorite risings that I've seen in the last mm-hmm. 4 years. And, mm-hmm. and the reason I loved it so much is that there were so many different sectors that were there. Right, mm. there were Lumads, there were farmers, mm-hmm. there were workers, mm-hmm. there were migrants, there were the LGBTQ community. Mm-hmm. It was mm-hmm. all, but what was so amazing was that each community danced their dance the way they danced their dance.
Uh-huh. They each in had, costume.
In
here.
Costume. They each had their own individual, this is my way, this is what I'm, and everybody danced, yeah. everybody's dance. Yeah. So what you saw is the building of what the new world looks like.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Like we all are part of each other's struggles. Yeah. I uh-huh. stand up for the Lumads. The Lumads stand up for gay and trans and bi people. The bi people stand for the migrant workers. Yeah. The migrant workers stand for the workers. We're all integrated into yeah. one story. And yeah. when that happens, uh-huh. we will see system change.
That's
we will
true.
See real That's paradigm true. Change because yeah. when we have that kind of solidarity, both internally and externally, mm-hmm. we'll be unstoppable.
Mm-hmm.
And dance does that because dance melts boundaries. Mm-hmm. You know, when we're dancing together, we don't know what class we are, we don't know what our story is, we just want to dance, we want to move with each other, we want to be together, we want to, mm-hmm. It's because it feels fabulous, you know? And at the end
and
of
the energy is powerful.
Yes. So how many countries are staging events and how many participants are expected globally for 1 Billion Rising?
Well, we just had.
I think now it's more than 200 countries again. Uh-huh. We didn't even know there were 200 countries, but people, when they write us, they say, we're a country too, so can you please list us? Mm-hmm. And there are thousands of groups all over the world. Mm-hmm. We used to want to encourage everyone to sign up on the website, but because it's such a decentralized movement, they have their own. We have like 200 plus Facebook pages of various countries all around the world. And all throughout the year, we're still getting footage, even from last year's Rising, because people, because of social media now, want to share and show what their Rising has been. So I think we're expecting millions again around the world. Uh-huh. And now it used to be just Feb 14, which moved to March 8th because it's International Women's Day. Yeah. But now we're seeing it's all year round. Yeah. When there's an issue, when there's an urgent thing that needs addressing, women and men are rising everywhere, and I think it's just an energy now that they're using even for existing local campaigns. Yeah. Uh-huh. Because, you know, it's very disarming, because normally a formal protest is like a rally where people are shouting or you have a discussion group. Then when you break out into dance, it's like it's a different energy, and it actually allows people's discourse to come in, like, for example, attention from the media, number one, and also sustaining interest in ending violence against women and girls, because that has been all our challenge for 30 years. Yeah. You know, like, people get tired, they get weary. Mm-hmm. And in a way, that's what patriarchy wants to happen. Yeah. That we're all going to get so tired that we're not going to continue.
Yeah.
But what One Bin Rising and Dance do is give people hope.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's really hopeful to use your bodies. And I think that is also unstoppable. Mm-hmm.
It's also revolutionary. Yeah. I mean, I think one of the things, having just, you know, we just passed through February 14th, you know, a few weeks ago, and looking at, for example, Somalia, you know, where women haven't been able to speak out. It's such a difficult place. You know, our activist Fartoon has been doing it there for 3 years. This year, they were out and about. They had the government, they had allies, they had actors, and you can see, you push the boundary, women begin to talk further. Mm. You push the boundary, women begin to speak up. And I think when you see that you're in this with 200 countries, it's much easier for people to fight in dangerous situations within their own country. Mm-hmm. You know, and also just to see how many kids, how many youth are rising, how many schools are rising. Yes. Dancing at the same
Dance Scholastica.
Oh my God, with 5,000 girls a few weeks ago was unbelievable. The energy of those girls.
Before we run out of time, it's March 8th is the big day coming up. What's happening on International Women's Day? And how can people get, you know, the message for International Women's Day on March 8th. That's in 2 days.
Yeah, yeah. I think International Women's Day is shared all across the world. It's now become like an extension of our Feb 14, 1 Billion Rising. Mm-hmm. And I think, again, you know, any opportunity for women and men to gather to really bring up the cause of women and ending violence is always a sacred day. And so we really encourage everyone, if you don't have a rising or an event going on even on March 8th, then create one, join one, do one, do a flash mob, just dance wildly, speak out, you know, create your own events. And really, art and activism is so potent. So use art, use creativity, which we've seen all across the board with One Billion Rising, because art is the biggest form of revolution, we truly believe. Yeah. And, you know, March 8th is definitely a day where we can keep highlighting the issues for women.
Okay. And I would say, having just been in the Philippines, that let's bring the Lumads home for March 8th. Mm. Let's stop the killing. Let's stop the harassing. Mm-hmm. They are our indigenous mothers and fathers. They know our mother. They know the land. Mm-hmm. They protect the mother. And I think it's really important that particularly people in this country really protect the Lumads and say, let's make their world safe on March 8th. Let's get the military out of their mountains and let's let them go home.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you so much. There's so nothing much else. There's only, it's a half hour program, but You know, it flew by. Thank you so much,
Eve,
Monique,
for
being with us here in Art2art.
Thank you.
And of course, more power to 1 billion rising.
On
March 8th.
Yes. Let's rise,
all rise
wherever you are.
Let's all dance.
Yep.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. As a woman, as a mother, I am truly grateful.
Thank you.
Hanggang sa susunod na linggo, samahan niyo kami ulit dito sa Art2art kung saan ang usapang sining at kultura ay para sa lahat. Ito po ang inyong balerina ng bayan, Lisa Macuja, nagpupugay sa Artistang Pilipino.